Introduction to Hepatobiliary Ultrasound. Hi, my name is Simin, a radiographer from Singapore General Hospital. Beginners in ultrasound are often overwhelmed by the need to simultaneously optimize technical settings, produce images of good diagnostic quality, interpret images accurately, and to ensure the clinical question is well addressed. We hope to make learning ultrasound more manageable by demonstrating basic transducer skills along with real-time in vivo ultrasound anatomy. At the end of this teaching video, you will be able to demonstrate a basic understanding of how a hepatobiliary ultrasound is performed, identify relevant ultrasound anatomy on a hepatobiliary ultrasound, and recognize some of the most common pathologies. In this video, we will be demonstrating the way to scan and interpret the normal liver, gallbladder, pancreas, and spleen. Basic pathologies such as fatty liver, cirrhosis, and gallstone will be discussed. The liver is the largest organ in the abdomen. As such, it cannot be assessed in its entirety with just one image on the screen. It is essential that the examiner scan the liver systematically. We begin with the longitudinal plane of the left hepatic lobe. The patient lies supine. The transducer is aligned parallel to the mid-sagittal plane with its superior end just below the xiphoid process. To assess the lateral segments of the liver, angle the transducer towards the left of the patient slightly. In this view, we can see segment 2 superiorly and segment 3 inferiorly. Caudate lobe, or segment 1, is separated from the left lobe by the ligamentum venosum as depicted by this echogenic line. The left hepatic vein can be seen draining into the inferior vena cava, which eventually returns the blood to the heart, as you can see superiorly. Continue angling the transducer to the left to ensure the lateral segments of the left lobe are fully examined. Next, we angle the transducer to the right of the patient slowly. Notice the left portal vein coming into view. In this plane, we are looking at the medial segment of the left lobe, namely segment 4. Again, ensure the medial left lobe is fully screened by angling the transducer all the way to the right. We examine every organ and pathology in two planes. To achieve the transverse plane of the left lobe, we turn the transducer in a 90-degree anti-clockwise fashion from the long plane. More often than not, doing so alone will not give us this image on the left with the hepatic veins clearly visualized. What we need to do then is to angle the transducer towards the patient's head or cranially. In this plane, we can see the left hepatic vein and middle hepatic vein draining into the IVC. The left hepatic vein separates segment 2 from segment 4A, while the middle hepatic vein separates the entire left lobe from the right lobe. More specifically, it delineates segment 4A from segment 8. Angle the transducer cranially to ensure a full coverage. As we angle the transducer caudally, the hepatic veins disappear from view while the left portal vein comes into view. With this landmark, we are no longer looking purely at the superior segments of the left lobe. What we are looking at now are segments 3 and 2 laterally and segments 4A and B medially. Again, we see the caudate lobe separated from the left lobe by the ligamentum venosum. The IVC forms the right border of the caudate lobe. Because the left portal vein is at a more superior level than the right portal vein, we do not see the right portal vein in this plane. Rather, we can still see parts of the middle and right hepatic veins, which separate segment 8 from 4 and segment 7 from 8 respectively. As we continue to angle the transducer caudally, the splenic vein comes into view. At the level of the splenic vein, we can see the falciform ligament, which is echogenic. It is an important landmark demarcating segment 3 from segment 4B. In this plane, segments 2 and 4A are no longer visualized. Turn the patient to the left lateral oblique position. To achieve the transverse plane of the right hepatic lobe, align the transducer to the right costal margin. The amount of cranial angulation needed differs from patient to patient. In this plane, we can see the middle and right hepatic veins draining into the IVC. As mentioned earlier, the middle hepatic vein demarcates the medial left lobe from the right lobe. The right hepatic vein further distinguishes segment 8 from 7. As we continue to angle cranially towards the hepatic dome, we can see the highly reflective diaphragm causing mirror image artifact of the liver parenchyma. Ring down artifacts caused by gas in the lungs can also be seen. The hepatic dome is considered a blind spot in ultrasound and warrants a careful evaluation. With a caudal angulation, the right portal vein with its anterior and posterior branches will come into view. At this level, parts of the middle and right hepatic veins can still be visualized, allowing us to identify segments 8-5, which are supplied by the anterior branch of the right portal vein, and segments 7-6, which are supplied by the posterior branch. More inferiorly, at the level of the right kidney, we are looking at segment 6 posteriorly and segment 5 anteriorly. There is no shortcut to take in ultrasound. Here, you can see how we ensure the rest of the right lobe is fully examined. To obtain the longitudinal view of the right lobe, align the transducer along an intercostal space. Make minor adjustments to the transducer angle to see the right hepatic vein. In this plane, we are mainly looking at segment 7. As we angle the transducer slightly to the right portal vein comes into view. The right hepatic vein can be seen too. Portal veins demonstrate thick and echogenic walls, whereas hepatic veins have thin walls. Another way to differentiate these two vessels is by putting on color Doppler. The color bar comes with a baseline, above which represents flow direction towards the transducer, as in the case of a normal portal vein demonstrating hepatopeter flow. The hepatic vein, on the other hand, demonstrates hepatofugal flow, which is away from the transducer, represented by blue. The comparison view between the liver and kidney can be obtained via intercostal or subcostal technique. Normal liver echogenicity is defined as isoechoic to the kidney or slightly hyperechoic to the kidney. This slide shows a comparison between normal and fatty liver. In fatty liver, the echogenicity is markedly hyperechoic to the kidney. On this slide, we have a comparison between a normal liver and a cirrhotic liver. The two most common ultrasound features of cirrhosis can be seen here: coarsened echotexture and an irregular contour. The portal vein appears slightly enlarged, which could be due to background of portal hypertension. With the superior end of the transducer at the medial part of the right costal margin, locate the common duct. You may need to angle your transducer, rotate the inferior end of your transducer towards the left of the patient, or slide your entire transducer along the costal margin to achieve a good image. The common bowel duct typically lies anterior to the main portal vein in the portal hepatis. The hepatic artery lies between them. The duct is measured from inner wall to inner wall and usually measures under 6 mm. The rule of thumb, however, is to assess the entire length of the common duct distally to the pancreatic head. The gallbladder is pear-shaped with pencil-thin echogenic wall measuring under 3 mm. A normal gallbladder should be entirely anechoic. In this patient, however, we see an echogenic focus casting strong posterior shadowing. These are typical features of a gallstone. A change in patient position should cause the stone to move too. The pancreas is a retroperitoneal organ. The pancreatic head drapes over the lateral aspect of the portal confluence while the neck lies directly anterior to it. The body and tail of the pancreas are found anterior to the splenic vein. At the lateral margin of the pancreatic head, we can see the gastroduodenal artery anteriorly, whereas the distal common bowel duct can be found posteriorly. This image was taken at the level of the superior mesenteric artery. Deep to the pancreas, we can see the aorta lying over the vertebra with the IVC to its right. Anterior to the pancreas, we can see the gastric antrum and the left hepatic lobe, both which can act as good acoustic windows for the pancreas. To image the pancreas, place the transducer in the transverse position at the mid-epigastrium. slide or fan the transducer caudally until the pancreas is visualized. Scanning during suspended inspiration or expiration and changing the patient's position to the right decubitus or erect can optimize the ultrasound views of the pancreas. Asking the patient to push his stomach out or giving water to fill the stomach are ways to better visualize the pancreas as well. The uncinate process of the pancreas is best visualized with the sagittal view. With the portal confluence at the center of the image, rotate the transducer 90 degrees clockwise. The uncinate process is seen in relation to the superior mesenteric vein. The pancreatic tail can sometimes be seen using the spleen as an acoustic window, with the splenic vein as the landmark. If we see a lesion at the splenic hilum, differentials should always include a pancreatic tail lesion. The spleen lies in the left upper quadrant of the abdomen. To achieve the longitudinal position, the patient is placed in a right lateral oblique position, with the transducer aligned along an intercostal space. It is often helpful to raise the patient's left arm so as to widen the intercostal space. Angle the transducer slightly cranially. The spleen is examined in its entirety through the intercostal spaces by sweeping the transducer medially or laterally. Did you notice a small round isoechoic nodule near the inferior pole of the spleen? It represents an accessory spleen or splenunculus and is most commonly located at the splenic hilum. Presence of a vascular supply from the main splenic artery can be demonstrated with color Doppler. With this, we have come to the end of the teaching video. Mastering the technique of scanning the hepatobiliary system takes time, and we hope this video will be a good stepping stone for you in this journey. Thank you for your time.